Recently, I made a video which featured ellipsoids. Big fan. I thought, however, it might be nice to take a closer look at the shape that is the ellipse, because a circle has just got one radius, r, whereas an ellipse has a major axis a and a minor axis b. It's like it's got two different values for its radius. It's a more generalized version of a circle, and my goodness, is it lovely. So the area of a circle is pi r squared, that's r times r, whereas the area of an ellipse is pi a times b. It's the same thing, but generalized. And the perimeter, the distance around a circle, that's 2 pi r. And the equation for the perimeter of an ellipse is... what the? It's true. There's no neat equation for the perimeter of an ellipse. It's insane. And we're going to have a look at that. But first, I want to define some elliptical terms. And I want to thank Jane Street, who are not only the principal sponsor of my entire stand-up maths channel, so all these videos you watch, you've got them to thank, but applications are now open for paid internships in any of these areas at Jane Street in New York, Hong Kong, and London. I'll have details in the description and at the end of the video. I'm going to do like in any other business thing with more about Jane Street, and I've got an update on tens of primes, which are bigger than the prime, and a few announcements. That's all at the end. Now, however, we have ellipses to deal with. We've already met A and B, the major and minor, the big and the small axes of an ellipse, but there are other values based on those. So you've got H. I don't really know what the physical interpretation of H would be, but whatever the case, it's super handy in other calculations involving ellipses. So when you see an H, it's just the square of the difference between A and B divided by the square of the sum of A and B. There you go. And we've got the eccentricity of an ellipse. And, oh, okay, it's similar, but now it's the difference between the squares, square rooted, divided by A. Why not? And that's got more of a physical interpretation. That's kind of a measure of how far from a circle the ellipse is. So if the eccentricity is equal to zero, it's a circle. And if it goes all the way up to one, that's like a super extreme ellipse, and everything in between. Up next, all ellipses have two focal points other than a circle, which only has one. And actually you can define an ellipse in terms of those two focal points. It's just the locus of all the points, which if you add the distance to both focal points, you get a set value, which means you can draw an ellipse by getting a piece of string or thread to represent that fixed length. You attach it to the two focal points, and then you draw all the points which the two distances add to the original string, and there you are, you get an ellipse. This also links back to the eccentricity of an ellipse, because if you take the distance C from the center to the focal points, you divide that by A, you get the eccentricity. And for the case of a circle, both focal points are right at the middle, C is zero, eccentricity is zero, the whole thing ties together. Oh, and the focal points have some physical representation, light, mirrors, blah, blah, blah. One last definition based on how I actually use ellipses. I try to always use A as the major longer axis, and actually, I always work it out in terms of its ratio compared to B. So actually, I set B to 1 and then work out how long A would be. And yes, B could have other values, but if you do it as the ratio, whatever length you get for the perimeter, you can just multiply it by B to scale it up. So unless I specify otherwise, whenever I talk about a value or a size or a type of ellipse, I'm just referring to the ratio between the major and minor axes. That's it for definitions. Let's get into it. I sent an email from someone named David about a week or two ago, and in it, they said that they were astounded to discover that there is no well-defined equation for the perimeter of an ellipse. I was astounded as well. I went racing across, found my wife. Lucy, I said, did you know there's no well-defined equation for the perimeter of an ellipse? And she said, but what about orbits? Great response. And in David's email, they had mentioned that Kepler, when working out the orbits of the planets, had to use an approximation for the total distance that something in orbit would travel. And I was like, well, this is crazy. How have I never come across this before? But sure enough, if you want to calculate the perimeter of an eclipse using a neat, well-defined equation, you have to use an approximation. So to look at how some of those approximations work, I'm going to use a scale where we have one at the one end, which is the case for a circle. It's where the ratio between A and B is exactly one. And I'm going to go all the way up to five, an ellipse which is five times as long as it is high. I figure that's our normal kind of eclipse range. The first naive approximation is just to take the arithmetic mean of A and B. So you average the major and minor axis and take that as the radius. We can now compare how accurate that is compared to the true perimeter of an ellipse by looking at the percentage error. And I'm going to put 5, 10, and 15% on my plot. And if we put that on, you can see it's pretty good. It doesn't get worse than 10% until you get to 4.83. And that's not bad. By the way, this is going to get very busy. I apologize if I stand behind bits of the plot. We'll see what happens. Our next step up is to take the geometric mean, and I believe this is one of the ones that Kepler used. However, it is substantially worse. The error just goes racing off. You go past 15% after a ratio of only 2.63. That's not great. If you want to do better than both of those, one of the most popular approximations I've seen, I've even seen bits online where people say it's the exact value of the perimeter, which is absolutely not true, is a kind of, I don't know, what is it? It's the average of the squares of A and B, but then you square root it. So I don't know, whatever you want to call that average, it is way better. So by the time we get to five, it's still only 7.8% inaccurate, and it won't hit 10% until after 10. So if you need a rough approximation, that's a pretty good option.
A total ellipse of the chart.
When I went looking for better approximations, I came across this one. It's got A and B, some threes, and of course, a pi. And this one was discovered by none other than Ramanujan. Of course, the incredible mathematical genius that was Ramanujan went looking for an approximation for the perimeter of an ellipse and somehow found something as beautiful as this. And it is pretty good. So let's see how it looks on our plot. And that is substantially better. I should also point out that we are no longer looking at 5, 10, and 15% error. This is 0.005, 0.01, and 0.015% error. So this is like 1,000 times better than what we had before. Ramanujan, as always, has come up with the goods. Here's the thing. For all of Ramanujan's incredible, once-in-a-generation genius and just mathematical insight, I've got something that they didn't have. I've got a laptop. And if Ramanujan made one major mistake with their mathematical career, it was having it in the past. So even though I only know just enough mathematics to be dangerous, I can outsource a lot of it to this machine. So I went through and wrote a program to try and find an equivalent, or maybe better, approximation. And I came up with this one. So this is 53 times A divided by 3 plus 717 B divided by 35, subtract all that stuff under the square root. This is my ellipse length approximation. Let's see how mine fares in comparison. And okay, it's different. You can see lower down, not as good. Ramanujan's does a lot better. Mine has a different shape to it though. So instead of just kind of racing off, it bounces along. And that was strategic. I wanted to get something which could stay lower for longer. And that bouncing up and down is actually because I'm taking the absolute value of the percentage error. In reality, it goes above and below. It goes negative and positive, but I just care how far away it is, not in which direction. The tide starts to turn at a value of 2.4, and after that, my formula does better. Ignore what happens a lot further that way. Not relevant. And it actually does so much better that if you average across the entire range from 1 to 5, my formula on average is roughly twice as good as Ramanujan's. And that's before you factor in that some of the errors would average out because technically some are negative, but even in absolute terms, twice as good. I have to admit, I was pretty proud when I worked that out. I will accept it does not look as pretty as Ramanujan's, and mine's not symmetric. You have to put in A as the bigger value, whereas Ramanujan's, they can go in either way. So as always, I gave it a go, pros and cons, very proud. If you think you can do better, wait to the end of the video. You'll have your chance. Not to be preemptively outdone, Ramanujan came up with more than one approximation. They had a spare, this one. So it's using H, and otherwise it's, you know, pretty standard. And it's not bad. If we add in Ramanujan's second approximation for the perimeter of an ellipse, it looks like this. That's it. It's that line at the bottom. It's incredibly accurate. It's about another 1,000 times better than Ramanujan's first one, or indeed mine. So once again, well played, Ramanujan. Well played.
There's nothing I can say, a total ellipse of the chart.
I know what's coming, by the way. I've once again discovered something which is good, but lacking. So of course people are gonna start calling it the Parker ellipse approximation. I'm braced, it's fine. But then I figured, if I'm gonna have an equation, which is good, but not great, why not embrace that? So I thought I would try to find another lazy approximation to rival where you just take the average, or one of the ones that we saw before. And I came across this. This is my lazy ellipse length approximation. You multiply A by 1.2, you multiply B by 0.75, add them together, multiply it by pi. Simple, and yet not bad. Here are the best two lazy approximations from before. I've taken out the geometric mean one because it's terrible, and we can now add in mine, and check that out, it's pretty good. So you've got the bouncing action from before. That's because it actually starts by underestimating the mean, and then it comes up to a positive overestimation. So the percentage goes from negative to positive. And actually, going to 5, you can't really see the full story. So I'm gonna rescale now and plot everything from 1 to 20. Now you can see how great my lazy approximation is. It starts with an error of 2.5%, then bounces, goes back up to 2.5%, and doesn't hit 2.5% again until you get to 14.4. And it doesn't get as bad as 5% until after 75. And who's having an ellipse which is 75 times as wide as it is high? That's just ridiculous. My lazy formula, with no need for square roots or anything too computationally intensive, never gives you a worse percentage than 6.1. And you could improve on it slightly. I picked the coefficients for ones that look neat, 1.2 and 0.75. If you had messier coefficients, which wouldn't be that much harder computationally, you could get an even better lazy approximation formula. And of course, if you think you can find a better lazy approximation formula, I want to hear about it. Details at the end of the video.
Total ellipse of the chart. Yeah. Total ellipse of the chart. A total.
Finally, what if you do need to know the perimeter of an ellipse exactly? During this video, I keep talking about comparing the approximations to the actual value. How did I get those actual values? Well, if you want to know it precisely, you have to use an infinite series. There are several available. This one is my favorite. You've got pi and a and b out the front, and our friend h makes an appearance again. And if you want a sufficiently precise value for the length, you just have to use enough terms. I used h to the 6th power as my max term a lot of the time for quick calculations, and then to do it thoroughly I found that if I went out to the 10th power of h, that was more than enough. So whatever level of precision accuracy you need. Just use sufficient terms. But technically, if you want to know the length exactly, you would need to use infinitely many terms in this sequence. Actually, it's a lot like pi in that regard. Wait a minute! This equation for the perimeter of a circle isn't neat and tidy at all. It's got a pi in it. And we can't get an exact value for pi without using an infinite series with infinitely many terms. The thing is, normally we just sweep all of these terms up and then we hide them underneath the pi symbol, hoping no one will notice. But they're still in there. Just because it looks neat and tidy doesn't mean mathematically it is. See? Check it out. Look, see? All those terms, they're still hidden in there. We just get fooled by how cute and adorable pi looks. So the equation for the perimeter of a circle is as badly behaved as any other ellipse. In fact, for all the other ellipses, for any given ratio, we could work out their own equivalent value of pi. They'd have their own circle constant for that specific ratio. It's just... Yes, I accept that pi is still quite special because you use it for the area for any ellipse. But the point is, when it comes to the perimeter, all ellipses are poorly behaved, including a circle. Now it's time for any other AOB business. Thanks again to Jane Street. Applications for internships are open in any of these areas. It's open to anyone who either is a student or recently was a student. Traditionally, it's a 10 to 12 week run between May and September. This will be in 2021, but if those dates don't work for you, they're flexible. And I highly recommend these internships. If you want experience in any of these areas, particularly if you think you might want to actually work at Jane Street, although of course you can do an internship and work somewhere else, then this is just a fantastic opportunity. You can also do it in the London, the New York, or the Hong Kong office. Take your pick. And I guess the biggest feature is probably that I might get to meet you. I've actually been to all three of those offices to have a chat with and meet the staff. And for the last 2 years, I've been to the London Jane Street office specifically to give a talk to the interns and then hang around afterwards for pizza and beverages. So if you do an internship at Jane Street, I might get to meet you. What a feature. More details at this website or in the description below. Please do pass them on to someone else if you think that the internship might be great for them. Okay, in other news, I've got a new podcast that has just come out this week with my Festival of the Spoken Nerd colleagues, Steve Mould and Helen Arney. It's called A Podcast of Unnecessary Detail, is exactly what it says. It's based on our live show of a very similar name. The first three episodes came out a day or two ago, and there's three more episodes to follow. So please do check it out. If you're enjoying this video and you're still watching now, I guarantee you will enjoy it. I've also got an update on the tan of a prime, which is bigger than that prime. Since the video went out, two more have been found. Someone found one with over 1,000 digits. In fact, several people sent in the same prime with 1,017 digits. Good work. And someone has found one more after that with 35,085 digits. So I'll probably do a follow-on video about that at some point. I've said a few times in the video, if you find a better formula for the perimeter of an ellipse, approximate or otherwise, then you can send it in to me. And that's going to be through Matt Parker's Maths Puzzles. The puzzle this week is all about ellipses. And the open question is, can you find a better approximation? So I will link to that below. That will have the full details of how you can send that in to me. And that's where the rest of that conversation is going to happen. So just over a week from now, I will provide the solution video to the ellipse puzzle. And in that video, I will give a breakdown of the other approximate formula that people have sent in. But check it out there. And very finally, I'm going to put the ellipse that I drew with a piece of string on eBay, with all proceeds going to charity. They all go to WaterAid. And I will write on both of the new Parker ellipse equations. I will sign it. You will also get the pen that I drilled a hole in, the bit of thread, and the two pins. You don't get the pin-up board, but you get everything else. All proceeds going to charity. Please do check it out on eBay. And that's it. Thank you so much for watching. Ooh, total ellipse of the chart. Yeah.
time for some subliminal messaging. Listen to our podcast, a podcast of unnecessary detail. It's got me and Matt Parker and Steve Mould, and also a lot of unnecessary detail. You can find it on all the usual places you find your podcast. You know, just search for the words unnecessary detail. I think you're getting the idea of this now. It's in everywhere you find your podcasts, and also on YouTube. He likes Bonnie Tyler. Who knew?
There's nothing I can say, a total ellipse of the chart.
A total ellipse of the chart.
Total ellipse of the chart.
A total ellipse of the chart.
A total ellipse of the chart.
There's nothing I can do, total ellipse of the chart.